Hello, Elizabeth.
Hello.
I'm very happy that you are here with me. I'm very happy that I'm here in Kenya.
Yeah.
I'm very happy that I'm meeting a climate activist, somebody who really knows what Kenya is feeling and what Kenya needs to fight the consequences of this disaster. So I will stop talking and I would listen to you. Tell me about Elizabeth and Kenya and climate.
Okay. So my name is Elizabeth Wathuti and I'm an environment and climate activist. And I'm also the founder of an initiative called Green Generation Initiative, which nurtures young people to love nature and be conscious of the environment when they are still young. And of course, I've always been passionate about the environment. This is something that dates back to my childhood because I grew up in one of the counties in Kenya that is known for its beautiful forests. It's called Nyeri County.
Nyeri County.
Yes. Which means that my childhood, of course, was full of nature and, of course, seeing the beautiful forest. And it was in a village where planting trees and drinking from clean streams was a norm. So it made me, as a child, be able to connect to nature when I was still at a tender age. And, of course, inspired by the late Nobel laureate, Professor Wangari Maathai, who at that time was the Member of Parliament for my home region. And, of course, also she used to do a lot of stuff in environmental conservation. And in whose memory as well, I was awarded the Wangari Maathai Scholarship Award in 2016 for my outstanding passion in environmental conservation and also personal initiatives to conserve the environment. So all this time, I remember when I was a teenager, it always broke my heart when I watched or read about how the forests were being destroyed and being burnt down. And of course, seeing how children in some parts of the world would not even breathe the free air that is given to us because it was too polluted for them. So they were forced to wear pollution masks to go to school. And just seeing how our rivers and waterways were flowing with plastic waste. And it was also so sad for me watching women and children having to walk for long distances to just go look for water and look for food for their families. So these are things that broke my heart so much, and I really wanted to do something about it. And I felt that, of course, I was not too small to make a difference. And I remember my first act as a climate activist was when I planted my first tree at the age of 7. And this is something that made me connect to nature, and this is something that made me become part of nature, and nature became part of me. And that is why today I am fighting for nature. That is why today I'm standing up and fighting to ensure that we don't have environmental degradation. Because all this environmental degradation that we have right now is killing our world. And killing our world means that it is killing our future as well. And the only best thing I can do and we can do is stand up and fight against this degradation. And also do the best that we can do to make sure that we are not part of the pollution, but we are part of the solution.
For me, it's really great that you, talking about climate, you talk about the environment, because that the issue is the environment. Climate is just an aspect of what we've done in the environment.
Yes.
And it's very important that we treat the whole picture.
Yes.
It's a perfect crisis we're going through.
Yes.
But let's go back to climate, because this is what is in the news because of its urgency.
Yes.
So how do you feel about the climate crisis in, let's talk about Africa, the continent, and your country, Kenya?
Yeah, of course, when it comes to the climate crisis, it's so clear that Africa is the least contributor of the global greenhouse gas emission.
So, Elizabeth, apart from being a climate activist and striking every Friday and trying to stir the world up, what else do you do?
So, being a climate activist for me, being an environmentalist and a climate activist for me means a lot. And it means addressing and demanding for change. And it also means what I'm doing right now to be able to be part of the solution towards the different environmental degradation issues that we have right now in the world. So in the year 2016, I founded Green Generation Initiative. That is an initiative that focuses on nurturing young people to love nature and be conscious of the environment at a young age. And this initiative focuses on practical environmental education for the children, because we have to expose them to nature and the environment at a young age. And that is the only way they are going to be change makers. For me, I believe that how we have interacted with the natural environment has got everything to do with how we are connected or disconnected from nature. And if you're disconnected from nature, then it means that you are not on the forefront in protecting nature, because you do not appreciate the value that comes with nature, and you do not appreciate the value that comes with living in a world that is livable, in a world where we don't have to suffer the consequences of previous generations, and in a world where we don't have to suffer the consequences of human nature, that is human nature causing environmental degradation. So that is why I started these practical environmental education forums for the children, because for me, having planted my first tree at the age of 7 years, it means that it made me connect to nature at a young age, and it made me appreciate nature. And that is why today I am fighting for nature. So I imagine of that world where we will have many, many more children that get to love nature and are connected to the environment at a young age, and actually understand what their role is in conserving the environment. And that is why I founded this initiative, to be able to nurture more young people to grow up in that same knowledge. So I also focus on addressing food security. Food insecurity in Africa is one of the challenges or impacts of the climate crisis right now, where we have millions of people still going hungry every day, and most of the affected still remain to be children. And one of the time when I was running an environmental education forum in the schools, I would notice that some children would remain in class when we send them out for breaks. And the reason was that they did not have anything to bring to school. They did not have any meals for them to eat when the rest were having their lunch. So it kind of broke my heart, and I thought, what can we do for these children through this program to make sure that at least they have something nutritious for them to eat every day? So we started to establish food forests in the school. And by food forest, I mean planting mixed types of fruit trees in a designated corner in the school. That would mean that that is going to be a forest, and at the same time it's going to bring food, and the fruits that are going to grow out of that forest are going to be used to facilitate the school's feeding programs. So this program was a program by the community and for the community, that is the school children, because they are the ones that are involved in planting these tree seedlings. So we use a campaign that I dubbed Adopt a Tree campaign, which is to ensure that we inculcate in them a tree growing culture, because the world is planting millions of trees. Every part of the world is planting millions of trees, which is so good. But it is not enough to just plant millions of trees and then not take care of them to maturity. So the world needs to stop just planting, and we need to start growing the trees by making sure that every tree planted gets to grow up to maturity, because that is only when we are going to say that we have made an impact. Impact is not planting millions of trees. Impact is how many of the millions of trees planted actually get to grow up to maturity. So that is why this campaign is helping inculcate a tree growing culture among the children, because every child gets a tree, they are able to plant the tree, and they're able to nurture that tree and take care of it until it grows up to maturity, and they take good care of it until they are done with their time in that school. So it is something that is helping us also increase the tree cover in the country right now, because our forest cover in Kenya stands at about 7.3%, and there is a national target right now to hit a 10% forest cover by the year 2022. So I believe that this program is also playing part and parcel in helping Kenya attain and surpass the 10% forest cover target right now, because we need to start looking at how we will grow the trees. And then also another program has been greening the schools, because we cannot teach people about a nature that they are not able to see. I mean, we have destroyed the environment so much until it's a worry that our children will probably have nothing to see when they come to this world. I mean, we will just show them things, plants and animal species that went extinct. And that is not what I want for my future and the future of my children and my children's children. I mean, we need to change and be mindful of how we are going to be leaving this planet for generations to come. So we started to do a program that is called Greening the Schools, that is bringing nature to the children in their schools. Because of course you find that some of the schools don't have the green aspect. Some of the schools don't probably have even a single tree, and some of the schools don't even probably have the grass that they can even sit on when they're having their lunch. Some of them would sit on bare soil, and you can imagine it on bare soil and the scorching sun, and they have to eat their meals. So this is something that also affects their studies. So the Greening Schools program came to try and beautify their schools so that we can bring nature close to them, because they will only understand nature if they spend time with nature. So this program is to ensure that these kids get to love the nature and get to love their surrounding environment, so that they can be on the forefront in protecting it for the sake of the future and for the sake of creating that livable world right now. So that are some of the programs that we have been doing at Green Generation Initiative.
Fantastic. So it's great that you, when I ask you about the climate situation, you talk about the environment, because the environment encompasses everything. And you're absolutely right, because it's the environment we've been hurting for so long and creating all the problems we have. Climate is just a part of our, of the results of our behavior. Yes. But we have to go back to climate. Climate is the more urgent as things are at the moment.
Yes.
So talk to me about the climate situation in the continent of Africa, in Kenya. How do you view all that?
Yeah, so it is so evident right now to everyone and to the rest of the world that Africa remains the least contributor to the global greenhouse gas emissions, but yet Africa suffers the most from the impacts of the climate crisis. And it is so evident even from my own country. A few months ago, towards the end of 2019, we had so many impacts of the climate crisis being visible to us, starting with the heavy erratic rainfalls that we had that led to a lot of floods, landslides and mudslides that left a lot of people dead and also left others displaced. And of course it happened in the East African region, not just here in Kenya. And of course these are issues that the world still remains silent to. And what makes me so sad and so angry sometimes is the fact that the world assumes that because these things are not happening in the rest of parts of the world, then it's not happening anywhere else. And I mean, people need to know that for us in Africa, it is not about what is going to happen in terms of the climate crisis. It is about what is already happening to us right now and how this is going to even get worse. Because if action is not taken, then we the people in Africa keep suffering. And we're suffering for a problem that we did not even contribute to most, that is the climate crisis. So, and this is just one of the many impacts that we have been facing here in Africa. Another thing is that the women and the children have been the most hit by this crisis. And that is why when drought hits, they are the ones that have to trek for long distances to look for water that is not even available. Because they can trek and come back with empty cans. And they can trek and come back with water that is not even safe for them to drink because the water is not available for them.
The water you used to drink from the clean fountains when you were young.
Yeah,
it's not there anymore.
Yeah, right now the streams are running dry. And most of these people in the dry parts of the country, when drought hits, it becomes prolonged. So, I mean, they suffer from the water crisis as well. So the climate crisis here is leading to many other crises in Africa. And one of them, of course, is like the water crisis. And of course, also the conflicts that we find, because if the resources that we have are not enough for the people in Africa, then we will have the crisis. I mean, we'll have the conflicts of people having to struggle for the little that is available to feed them. And these are sad things that I think the world should begin to pay attention to, because...
And sorry to interrupt. And in the resources that are scarce, suddenly you get locusts.
Yes.
The invasion of locusts.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that.
Yeah, yeah. So like right now, we are suffering from the...
Okay, go on.
So right now we are having the worst desert locust invasion in 25 years. And this is something that has really become a threat to food security, because these locusts are destroying everything that they find on their way. So it is something that is causing a lot of anxiety to the people, to the farmers, because Kenya in particular is a country that depends on agriculture. And if the desert locusts keep destroying everything in our farms, then it means that this is a threat to food security. And this means that it's kind of an alert to the issue of hunger in the country and what is going to happen in the next few years after these desert locusts cause all these disasters. So these are things, these are strange things that have never been seen in Africa, or if they have been seen, it's been for a period of a long time. For instance, the locusts, like I said, it's been like for over 25 years we've not had this invasion. But now it's here and people do not even know how to handle it. Like, we had the government trying to spray the locusts, but there was no impact. And of course, so even the sprays as well is not something that is sustainable, because these are chemicals.
It's poison.
Exactly, it's poison to the crops. And it means that these are disasters that are really affecting the African continent. This also means that it means that the money in Africa now has to be used to solving these challenges instead of trying to see how we can sustainably develop as a continent. So it is a challenge that the world needs to remain woke to.
So, Elizabeth, climate crisis, COP 25, was that your first COP?
Yeah, COP25 was my first COP.
So, presumably, in theory, COPs are there to try to get everybody to fight together to halt the reverse climate change. What is your impression of COP25? How did that go for you?
For me, COP25, of course, did not give me the impression that I had when I went there, because I felt like it was a total fail, for the fact that most of the very important issues that should be being discussed at this point in time were not anywhere on the table. The issues such as loss and damage for countries that are suffering most from the consequences of the climate crisis, these are things that we did not hear coming out so clearly. And then the fact that there was no outcome out of the COP25 gives it the whole impression that it was a fail. Because why should we sit down to discuss things that we have been discussing for the past years? And yet, when we are supposed to be taking the action, we are still trying to argue and negotiate about things that should not be even on the negotiation table. I mean, science is not negotiable. So instead of sitting down and negotiating when people are dying and are suffering out there, the places that are the most hit by the impact of the climate crisis, like Africa, people should be discussing about the actions that are being taken and how we can do better. But now the COP did not have, there was no hope in the COP. And I mean, it also makes us wonder how it's going to be in COP26. If at all the same things keep recurring every now and then, like our leaders and the global leaders and the politicians and all these people that have the biggest responsibility when it comes to making decisions on the climate crisis, they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Instead, what they're doing is negotiating and discussing about things that they're not even doing right now. So I mean, that was the most disappointing thing for me in the COP25.
On the other hand, it was me having attended a few more COPs than you.
Yeah.
It was the first time the youth had a presence.
Yeah.
It was given a stand to speak.
Yeah.
People seemed to listen. How do you interpret that?
Yeah, I think the fact that we had a lot of youth presence in COP25, number one, was a plus. Like, it is something that was positive. But on the other hand, we feel like we are being misunderstood by the world. Like, they do not understand what the youth want. It is okay we are having the voice. It is okay they are giving us platforms to speak and say what we want and share our demands. But it is not okay to just give us voices and spaces to speak and then fail to meet our demands. It doesn't make any sense. So that is the most disappointing things about what is going on with the youth spaces and the youth platforms that we are being given. It is not enough for you to just give us the voices and the platforms to speak. What we want is to be listened to, and then we want you to act upon our demands. That is the only thing that is going to make an impact and a difference at the end of the day. It's not going to make a difference if you keep giving 100 youths places to speak, and yet once they leave the stage, you keep ignoring what they're saying. So how is it in the end going to help us in addressing this crisis if you keep ignoring the young voices that are going to live longer with the consequences of your decisions today?
So, if I can interpret what you're saying, is like they used youth to greenwash COP25, really.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that they feel like, because you're giving us platforms and opportunities to speak in high-level platforms, then that is what we want. No, we are speaking because we want to see a change, we want to see a difference. And if we just speak and then our voices are not heard or are not listened to and are not acted upon, then it means that we are still being ignored at the end of the day. And speaking and being ignored does not make any difference at the end of the day. It is the same as not speaking at all.
You mentioned in your previous answer about the future.
Yeah.
How do you feel that people who don't really have a future beyond 5 or 10 years decide for your future, which is to be the next decade or even the future of the unborn? So,
I think I'm really happy right now that the young people and the children are seeing the urgency, and are not just seeing the urgency, but they're acting upon it. They're out on the streets demanding the governments and world leaders to act. They're out in their communities working on the ground to meet these actions that we're actually talking about already. But the fact that the world leaders are not aware that we are the ones that are going to live longer with the consequences of the decisions is what worries us the most. the fact that they do not understand that we are fighting because we want a livable world now, and we are fighting because we want a safe future. And there is no way that we are going to have that safe future if they do not create for us a livable world right now. And that is why for us it is not something that we are begging for, because addressing the climate crisis is our right, so we have to demand for it right now.
Very well said. Okay, climate crisis has a number of issues: mitigation, adaptation, resilience, loss and damage. One of the tools we have in our hands is to mitigate climate change is renewables. We have to end fossil fuels. I mean, I'm saying things that everybody should know, but it's worth to have them said again. What do you think about the renewables in Africa?
Well, I think there is an opportunity for Africa in the renewables. And I think one of the things that before even we talk about the renewables in Africa is that the fossil fuels have to remain in the ground if we have to address the climate crisis. Because there is no addressing climate crisis because we will not be addressing any climate crisis if the fossil fuels are not going to remain in the ground. I mean, that forms the basis of the solution at the end of the day. And the rich countries, of course, are the ones right now that are using most of the fossil fuels, and they developed by burning fossil fuels. And of course, when we say that we need the fossil fuels to remain on the ground, we are seeing a lot of resistance that is coming from the rich countries and, I mean, the people that developed using the fossil fuels. And when you come to the African continent, we are seeing that there is, of course, use of the renewables right now. But of course, Africa needs climate financing to be able to tap into the opportunities that come with using renewables, because right now you find that there are still homes in the African continent that still are not powered, people that do not have access to electricity, people that do not have access to, I mean, they don't have any access to power. So how can you be able to help these people that are suffering right now? We need to tap into the renewables, but then Africa needs climate financing to be able to ensure that all the renewable sources of energy are tapped into as it's supposed to be. And like, for example, in Kenya, I think 80% of our energy is renewable right now, which also as well sets a good example of the fact that we can actually go renewable and we can actually go 100% renewable.
You're like, you got geothermal energy, which is fantastic form of energy. So
yeah, So, I mean, it is something that, I mean, the whole world ought to look up to and the whole world need to turn to, because this is something that is about the future right now.
Yeah.
We cannot keep talking about a livable world if we keep killing people with coal. We cannot talk about a livable world if we keep burning the fossil fuels. They have to remain on the ground if we have to say that you have a bright future. I mean, I don't want anyone to look into my face and say that, I mean, they see the future is bright because I'm working on, I'm an activist. No, I mean, I want that future to be created for me right now. And of course, by going into renewable energy, we are going to be setting the base that we are trying to create right now in terms of having a livable world for our children and also for the next generations to come.
Totally agree, but that's irrelevant. Some of the people that I talk to in Africa tell me that, okay, you people in the West, in the developed world, you use fossil fuels, you developed, and now you want to use renewables. What about us? We have some fossil fuels. Why shouldn't we use to develop our economy? And then let's talk about renewables. What is your answer to that?
Well, my answer is that two wrongs can never make a right. So it doesn't mean that because the other rich countries developed by burning fossil fuels, then the developing countries should also develop by burning fossil fuels. No, because there is a future in sustainable development and there is a future in renewables. And it only, I mean, we're only going to realize it if we tap into it and then maximize our resources on how we are going to make sure that the renewable energy is actually going to help us in development. Because I mean, we need it for the future. We need to be able to minimize on the impacts that we are having right now on the climate crisis. So, I mean, we have no other option left than to just go renewable.
I think it's critical. You mentioned in your previous reply, climate financing.
Yeah.
Africa needs to be not financed, funded.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
they need to be funded to be able to move to renewables.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, Elizabeth, mm-hmm, you've been active. Publicly active,
yeah.
So be interacting with people of Kenya. Is your message getting across? What is your take of the society in Kenya?
Okay, one thing I would say about my work is that I appreciate the fact that I'm able to inspire more people to also take action, and especially my fellow young people, because when I started this initiative, for example, I was alone. I would go to schools and train the children to love the environment. I would go to schools and conduct environmental education sessions. But I started out when I was all alone. And then when I started to share information about what I'm doing, I got a lot of young people that were interested in joining me in my programs. And right now I'm really happy because in the initiative I have over 40 volunteers who are all young people that are passionate about the environment. And this is something that of course gives us hope that our voices and our solutions and our actions right now will actually change the world. And of course the biggest challenge here comes with bringing a change and making the decision-making, and hitting the decision-making platforms in the world, that is reaching the key decision-makers such as the global leaders. So for me, I feel like they are listening, yes, but I don't think they're actually taking into account what we are saying, because if they are taking into account, then we would begin to be seeing real action. We would begin to be seeing our demands being met. But then what we see is conference of parties after conference of parties, each and every year with no outcomes. I mean, it is really sad for us that we keep spending our times trying to make them understand and feel the urgency, but they don't spend their time to listen to us and take action. And yet we put them there to create for us that livable world, and we put them there to be able to make a difference in the world. So what would be the essence of a leader if their terms of leadership, I mean, they will not have created for us a world that is easy for us to live in? Because I mean, we are living in a world where the future generations have to suffer the consequences of the previous generations, and I think that should not be the case. I think everyone ought to be mindful of how they will leave this planet for generations to come. And what we are seeing right now is young people that are worried about how the future is going to be. I mean, if all the challenges we are seeing right now are only going to keep being worse because nothing is yet being done, we're only going to be hopeful if we see change, if we see things being done. Of course, we have hope because we are united and we are determined to make a difference, and we are determined to keep pushing for change and keep putting pressure on governments to be able to take action. That is what gives us hope most. But when it comes to the action from the governments, we are definitely not really hopeful because we have not begun to see real action. So our only hope right now is to keep putting pressure until we begin to see action, because we are the ones that are going to live longer with the consequences of their decisions today. So we cannot afford to sit back and watch our future get down to the drain. We have to rise up, hold hands together and fight.
Okay, that's a great message, but it's a great message. I hope it gets across to all youth, yeah, all globally. But we're practically in the last decade to act.
Yeah.
This is not me talking, not you or anybody else. Yeah. It's the scientist talking.
Yeah.
We have 10 years, half a degree. Australia is burning.
Yeah.
They're opening up the coal mine. They just gave permission to the coal mine to go ahead.
Yeah.
Brazil, when the Amazon is burning, the guy says DiCaprio is putting the fires and the environmentalists.
Yeah.
Trump says there's no global warming, CO2 is good for us.
Yeah.
Can you really be optimistic?
Well, I said what gives me hope, of course, is the fact that we are determined to make sure that it's not the same anymore. We are determined to make the world not continue with business as usual, because it's going to kill our future. Of course, we are worried. We are worried, and that worry and panic is what is giving us the hope to keep pressing on and to keep fighting, because we cannot give up. If we give up, I mean, we're the only ones taking action right now. The people that are supposed to be creating the future that we are trying to fight for are not doing anything. We are the only ones that are acting, and we are acting to demand for their action, but we don't see it yet. So of course, it gives us worry, definitely, because we don't know how the future is going to be. And because the people that are not even care, I mean, the people that do not even give, I mean, they don't even care about what they're doing right now.
Yeah.
I was trying to say that.
It's okay, ask, I can say it.
Yeah, it's annoying sometimes.
It's okay. It's okay.
Yeah. So I mean, the people that should be on the forefront in trying to make the key decisions in the world right now
are the wrong people.
Exactly, and they're not even doing anything about it. So it definitely just kills our hopes. It kills our hopes for our future. And the fact that even right now the world is not livable, we have children in different parts of the country that have to suffer from, I mean, diseases, they have to suffer from even just putting pollution masks to go to school. They have to suffer from having a degraded environment right now. They have to suffer because there's no food for them to eat. They have to suffer because their families and the only places they called home were washed away by the floods.
Yeah.
And there are people seated in their homes just enjoying life and forgetting that these children need a future and they need a life right now. So, I mean, we are hopeful, yes, but we are worried that the future is only going to get worse. And the thing that we want and we are demanding is that we want to see them taking the action that is needed to address this crisis.
The thing is, sorry to sound pedantic, but the thing is that you can, if you can manage to pass the message to us, all people, that before disaster gets us as well, we should act, because it's already getting so many of our co-human beings. So, Elizabeth, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope you'll continue with this passion and this spirit, and I'm sure you will.
Yeah.
And so long as you're united, you will succeed in that.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you so much.